A very good morning to everyone and welcome back. Let's start this day with again great energies and new perspectives. We are really glad to see many of you back here from yesterday for the day two of Sustainable Energy and Livelihood Nexus event, and for being part of yet another day of discussions and learnings. For people who have missed yesterday's sessions, here's a bit of summary of what happened yesterday and what our day looked like. The day was opened by Mr. Raghuram, the director of IIM Bangalore, followed by an opening address of Mr. Atik and keynote address by Mr. R. Ramanan. Then we had some really interesting discussions across our panels. A mix of micro entrepreneurs, enterprise incubators, last mile energy solution providers shared their challenges, experiences, and innovative solutions while developing models for livelihood solution dissemination. The panels on sustainable energy models for livelihoods, need-based technology, and the role of last-mile clean energy enterprises focused on the importance of overall ecosystem around energy access, technology, and role of enterprises. We also had two parallel roundtable discussions on irrigation and on last-mile refrigeration and cold storage. Simultaneously, we also had very interesting 30 live demonstrations of various entrepreneurs of their respective livelihood products and innovations. We shall be open today as well to the participants as well. And finally, the day was closed by Jeff Prince from IKEA Foundation, who closed the day with his remarks.
If yesterday was about an overview, technology and enterprises, today we focus on agriculture value chain, finance, and policy support systems around livelihood solutions. So today, we will be having a similar format, three main panels. One, on the role of energy in empowering agricultural value chain. Financiers who shall discuss the experiences, barriers, and opportunities in financing for energy livelihood intervention in the first half of the day in this main auditorium. And from 2:30, we will be having two parallel roundtable discussions on microfinance and sustainable livelihoods and sustainable energy-driven technologies for crafts and textile. The live demonstration by the various entrepreneurs of their respective livelihood products and innovation would also be open from 11 a.m. This would be a really good opportunity for everyone to directly interact with them and understand the holistic system, not just technology, but the finance, the market linkages, the challenges that they continue to face even today. The closing panel on creating a policy environment for scaling energy-driven productive applications across different types of underserved populations. This is how the day would look like. Before we go ahead and officially welcome everybody, some general instructions for the day. As you all know, all your dignitaries have a packed schedule. Respecting that, it's a humble request to everybody to cooperate, adhere to our timings for each event so that we can really sail smooth. Drinking water would be available right outside both the exits. The closest washroom is on my left side, here on this exit. In the welcome kit, we have given a bag which has the agenda, concept note, a notebook which has the bios of all speakers, and the agenda has the map that will take you to the demonstrations as well. If you need any assistance or help, get hold of our volunteers. They will be wearing the red patch.
Start with, we are extremely happy to have our opening speaker, Ms. Gayathri, Vasudevan with us. She co-founded LabourNet Services India Private Limited in 2006 with a vision to enable livelihoods and enhance quality of life through education, employability, and entrepreneurship. I welcome her on stage.
Morning, everybody. I think thank you so much for inviting me here. And as I was coming in, I was just thinking, if the entire discussion over yesterday was on livelihood, what would I add value to people who have actually worked on the ground? I think the difference. So I just want to share with you the my journey over the last 12 years and my learnings. And I'll actually take the last week as an example of what's going wrong with livelihood, actually, and our conception of livelihood. When we think livelihood, what do we think? We think money, income, wage, saying no. So that's the difference. All policy, all measurement of livelihood is on a single dimension, which is wage. And that too, you're looking at wage, which is going to come in a monthly wage format in your account. So all constructs of livelihood that we are doing are there. And I'll just spend a minute to explain this. Let's take, as I said, I'll take my last week's travel and then draw from that. I was in Himachal Pradesh and we're discussing what would be good for livelihood of youth in Himachal Pradesh. Can you give me three things which came as the hot ones which would be good for youth in Himachal Pradesh? Good livelihoods for youth in Himachal Pradesh. Anybody? Okay.
Education.
Sorry?
Education.
Food processing, is it?
Education.
Education, okay. Organic farming. Let me just spend a minute with each of these. Tourism seems to be an absolutely correct fit for Himachal Pradesh. What do you want to train a youth of Himachal Pradesh in Himachali youth in tourism? How do we want to train the person? That should be the logical one. But you know what we are training them on? I wish none of those things. When we are looking at tourism, we are looking at it in isolation. We are saying you please become a room attendant. You become a front office person. So you are actually devolved completely, you know, if I could use the word, it's like deforestation, you know. You are completely, whatever they have also you are taking that away from them. So what you're teaching in that 3 to 6 months as a course is actually going to de-skill them. Whatever they've learned water has to be preserved. You're actually teaching them that showers are okay to be there. There's no water. You're saying how to clean a shower cabinet. Look at the kinds of things, the kinds of hotels which are coming up there. They are not at all friendly to land. Come a month, 1 month hence, we are going to have a situation where there is no water in Shimla. Year after year we hear this, right? But what are we teaching? We are preparing plumbers to fix taps. We are preparing plumbers not to deal with what kinds of pipes should they be there. Should they be the kind of pipes which you are putting now, or are there different kinds of pipes? There is no thought process there. So the problem with livelihoods is we are looking at it as a one fit all. So typically a person who comes for skill training is a person who's a school dropout. In almost all the cases, you will find that they're either a 10th fail, 10th pass, 12th fail, 12th pass is the large majority which you will get. Now here, this person wants to be in a respectable job. Education defines for you what is respectable. They will say Himachali youth will not work with their hands but would want white collar jobs. Therefore, what white collar jobs would you want? BFSI, data entry operator, CRM non-voice. Now, just look at the dichotomy, right? In Himachal, nobody can own land, so no company is going to come and set up their industry in Himachal. By definition, it is not happening. It's only in the plain areas in Baddi or Hamirpur which you can have it, but you have a dichotomy in this. So you pick, and I'm just taking this because I just came from Himachal Pradesh yesterday and was feeling dejected, saying what are we planning for and what are we implementing? This is the classic problem that livelihood has. We are not at all thinking, why are we teaching somebody a skill set and how is the person going to make money? You're thinking, I will teach something and ensure 3 months job is available. 3 months is what you're planning for. Suppose a person is 20, the person's livelihood, the person needs to earn a livelihood for a minimum, I'm not even taking, I'm just saying at least 60 There's no plan for that. So the education system is pushing. So you have vocational education in schools. What do you think should be the vocations which school, it is a board exam subject. What should be the subject of vocation in Himachal, which would be right there? Tourism, right? But what tourism? What agriculture? Would you want to teach paddy there when you're actually doing a lot of, you know, there are a lot of fruits which are being grown there? Why are you not having that there? You're teaching floriculture in places where fruits are growing, saying replace fruits with floriculture. So I think the absolute dissonance that we have in our education system and skill is huge. And this is because of a single problem. All of us are worried that if I don't control input, then what happens to the output? And here, what is the problem? Who's paying for skill training? Either state is paying for skill training or CSR is paying for skill training. Both of these parties are not me. So both these parties want to be safe. And I don't blame them entirely because of the nature that we have created. You know, this is this whole animal that we have created. And we are all part of that, you know, in various forms, we are part of that whole beast that has come up. So I think I just took that as an example to say the problem that is there when you say enable livelihood. What do you mean by livelihood? I think we need to define. Of course one needs to earn. I have no doubt in my mind that you must earn a decent amount of money. There is no question there. And that has to be your, you know, North Star towards that to which you work. But that amount comes at what cost, at what time, and how do you facilitate it is an ecosystem thing. Now again, let me just flip back to some of the things which I think are relevant and, you know, could possibly be taken up. Today, tourism has exploded. I'm again sticking to one state, as I said, it's fresh in my mind, so I'm just sticking to that. Tourism has exploded, right? You have your OYO, you have your Airbnb, you have your traditional hotels. Should we not work with these chains to actually look to see what would sell? Where is our thought process as organizations where we work with them, say, what kind of an OYO hotel do you have? What kind of rooms should be there? And therefore, what should I backtrack and train? So when the SOPs are done, it is not only the state. It is for us to work with that chain of corporates. Which has happened, right? Now that's your biggest, if tourism is the biggest, that's the biggest chain that you need to work with. I think that's where we have the split between who pays, who's going to, who should be influenced and how should be influenced. We break the chain breaks at some of the places there. If I look at our work, I would say that we started with the idea that let's look at certification of informal sector workers. It was a very simple thesis at that point of time saying that if I'm able to say this is the standard against which you certify, then I'm able to bridge a gap, right? Because most in the informal sector, we started in the construction sector, they have skills. It's not like they come with zero skill sets. You have to certify and see what is that standard. But the standard today has become defined by groups which are actually outside the standard setting in that sense. They are defined by very, very middle class urban thought process of what is a standard. Cleanliness is a standard in tourism, no questions about it. You have to have communication skills, no questions about it. But what you teach within it matters. You know, the broad framework no one is questioning. I think it's the nuances which one needs to actually question. If you start with skill training, which is what LabourNet started with, the reality is you can't stick there. Over the years, we've had to become incubation support. We've had to look at financing for small entrepreneurs which are there. So how does we've taken value chains. We've taken painter, plumber, you know, value chains, and we're working on value chains. Then each of it at the last mile level, we find that there's absolutely none of the support which you have. So if you're English speaking, if your ability to stand here, and hopefully you're not profitable, your ability to get capital is very high. But most of the micro entrepreneurs actually beat this trend. They are profitable within the second month, but they are burdened with very high debt in order to ensure that they're able to function. And I'm just taking very, very simple ones, right? You're a plumber, you're a painter, you're a textile, if you look at small units which are coming up. What is viable, what is not? Where are the ability to train on a consistent basis, because these are not going to go to wage employment. And the number here is very high. You're talking of plus 70% of the population is in professions like this. You want to call them self-employed, micro-entrepreneur, you can define, the vocabulary you can take in multiple ways. I think the need of the hour today is to have strong incubation entrepreneurship ecosystems built for the poor. And when I'm saying poor, I'm actually taking a wide spectrum there. So you need actually layering them. That layering has to look at all the facets of it. Otherwise, we stand the danger of having unemployed youth being very, very frustrated because they are not able to think beyond or even foresee that they will have jobs beyond 3 months to 6 months. They will move from one to the other. Frustration builds. And this is a natural frustration which builds because you don't know what your next step is. You're figuring it out. You're figuring it out, saying, can I get that? But there is really no mechanism that you can reach out. Just imagine if you are 20 years old. You come from Bidar or you come from Belgaum or you come from, it can be 20 kilometers out. You can come from Kollegal. It doesn't matter. The difference between the two. Very recently, I watched this movie called Gully Boy. I don't know how many of you watched Gully Boy. Few. I'll be very honest. I pushed it to the end. I was not sure I like it. It's not, how should I put it? My defined movie that I would watch. But I thought that's the most appropriate movie of our times. It shows in Mumbai city, within a probably 5 kilometer radius, two graduates. Both of them are doing undergraduate studies. Two different social and economic realities, what really happens. The difference between the two is very, very, very large. And that is where the problem is. So I think we really need to look back when we are looking at skill training and not look at skill training in isolation with livelihoods. And today's economy is such that we may have to reskill multiple times. But I believe that if the foundation is good, everything else will build. See, one would want to reskill. Well, it's okay. Technology is changing. Times are changing. One would have to reskill. But at the end of the day, what are you going to show as that path? One doesn't know what will happen after 20 years. But one does know that you have to prepare for that 20 years. I don't think that's a question that any of us have. And I think we should take value chains. Each value chain needs to be gone in great detail to understand the mapping between education, skills, and employment. Employment cannot be thought of it's not black and white. It's not what is right here, what is wrong there. There is no right and wrong. Every learning is good. But what learning is appropriate and what learning at what points of time are appropriate, I think, needs to be thought through. I actually want to have a discussion, so I'll just stop in a minute. But where I want us to really think through is, look at the broad education and skill spectrum which is available to us today. The education spectrum is very known, right? Everybody finishes 10th and 12th. What do you finish in 10th and 12th? What do you learn at that points of time? It's very, very important for us to revisit that, especially because secondary education dropout is very huge in this country. If secondary education dropout is huge, we have to think through that. Now the gross enrollment ratio of people going into higher education has gone up tremendously. Now all of these people have a desire as to where they want to go. So how are you going to channelize it to show there are occupations which are okay to be, where you can earn? I don't want to be idealistic and say, you know what, you belong to whatever Himachal agricultural family, please do that. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying what could be viable options which are there, which are permanent. And when I mean permanent is where there is a path that you could see, that you can come back and reinvent yourself. Most of us sitting here have reinvented ourselves. I can say for myself, I must have reinvented myself at least 10 times, made multiple mistakes, so be it. But at least you know where you're going. You don't have to have, you don't have to be boxed in and feel frustration. I think that's the worry that is there. Skill training is seen in a duality. Skill training is seen as either education or skill training. Either skill training is for the weak, economically poor, intellectually poor is where skill training comes in. So we've created this absolute wall which we're not able to break. The glass is so, it's such a hard glass that you're unable to even knock it today. So I think those are places where we really need to rethink. And this at a point of time when there is rural distress. Undoubtedly, there are no jobs, no incomes people are seeing in rural areas. There is huge scale migration into urban areas. Urban, and it's not only your Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore. It's an urbanization which is happening at every tehsil headquarter. Every taluk and tehsil is getting urbanized. When it's getting urbanized, we need to now plan for it, saying that what does that urbanization mean for skills, for livelihoods? What does it mean? And how are we going to fit in? We don't need more four-bedroom, two-bedroom flats which are coming up at every area, which actually take away from livelihoods. Jobs are not getting created, contrary to popular, that saying the moment it is quote-unquote developed, it will get created. You're pushing a problem. When you're 35, you don't have a job. When you're 40, you don't have a job. You don't know what to do. So you're actually bucketing it. So as I said, I just want us to answer three questions from our experiences. What do we mean by livelihood? Today, I think a lot of the discussion is going to be on agricultural value chain, textile value chains. If we look at these value chains, they're all severely affected value chains. Today, if at least I understand textile, if not agriculture, very well. Textile, I do understand very well. Let's look at problems in these value chains and let's answer this question, saying what do we define as livelihood and how does that ecosystem get created? When we say ecosystem, what do we mean by it? Is it finance? Is it skill? Is it orientation? Is it actually infrastructure? Infrastructure is also missing in many, many places. So how do we really look at this in that manner? So anyone's viewpoints? Let me ask the question then. So let's take a very simple example, right? Everybody says that tailoring. There are tailoring hubs in and around Karnataka. Mysore, Hosur are all hubs that we have. If you go a little distance, you will go to Tiruvannamalai, you will have power loom hubs that are there. Now I'm not even saying don't touch power loom or these. Now what does this hub mean and how does it take it forward? I think let's answer these questions, and that's I think important for us as we take it forward. So basically his question is, let's take two hubs. There's a leather tanning hub which is in Trichy and then the other is in Tirupur, which is your textile. So if it's the leather, we all know in tanning there is a lot of chemicals which are being used. So the salt which basically the skin is actually cleaned out with. All of this is chemical use. It still happens because the person does not see an alternative. So he says, is there a solution to it? This is where I'm saying there's an infrastructure which an investment of the state is necessary. It's not individual
small tanning companies which will invest in it unless that entire hub, you're able to actually look at it from an investment which is a mass investment. Normally in the tanning all kitta irukum dura irukiradilla illaya pakkath pakkathla irukum suppose adhu common infrastructure irundhu common ah namba edutha da ipo ottara pota chinna chinna factories so they are very very small units so the small units are not able to make investments which are very large STP investments so there is an economic infrastructure which has to be thought through. Whereas, this is a classic example, I'm not so familiar with Chichi, but I'm very familiar with the Vellore belt. Where what has happened is, the STP infrastructure is only for the large companies. So the outsourced smaller units are outside this industrial estate at all, completely. And so they get closed down by the pollution board. Which means loss of livelihood on a frequent basis whenever pollution board cracks it. Pollution board is not wrong. But your infrastructure investment there has been only on two items, roads, lighting, that too not the industrial power. So your infrastructure investment has been outside the need of the place. Othukkireenga inga investment enga irukanga road la irukku ipo road alla nalla irukku illaya lighting a irukku but power for industrial power avale Tamil Nadu full la avale illaya. That's I think the where I was talking of is the ecosystem as to where public infrastructure investment has to happen, where private. In private, there has been no innovation in saying what kinds of tanning solutions do you require in order for there to be less water usage, less chemical usage. And if it is, it is not. Although I also train in this and am in this sector, I am also not aware. We don't even see it. It may be so classroom friendly, it's not go to market. So if market does not even have it, how would you actually inform? And that's I think a great example of exactly what I mean. So you will train tanners, you will certify tanners, you will give them new technology as a tick box, but it has no reality to application. So when you're looking at livelihoods, I consistently believe you have to go back to look at value chain and look at the multiple problem. The tanning industry is one industry which is down for about 3 to 6 months a year because pollution road will strike it, because you will have chemical, water shortage, all three put together, it's down for significant number of time, which means people don't earn money at that point of time. Why would you think anybody who's futuristic will come into the sector? No reason. It's actually beats any logic. I think that's where we need to really work on.
While working on various value chain, especially product, I just wanted to share a couple of our product like Jardoji and Chikintar. These are very historical handcrafted products from Lucknow and certain parts of Eastern UP as well. And almost 11 lakhs minorities group are very intensively involved. There was a time when the entire value addition used to be basically hijacked by outside forces now. And we had a small cursory kind of study with a cluster of villages. And we were surprised to know that almost 38% of the value addition of those forces, that the team, the women, were basically going into the other parts, not in the village economy. So the one which you're saying, what is that, the entire dynamics of livelihood, this is what I'm just trying to say with you. You see, Chikitkari or Jadoji is the name of the craft and it has a different process system. But only 99% people were making a craft, but other things were basically done by somebody people. And those numbers were in a very, very scarce number. If it requires washing, then almost at a distance of 30 to 60 kilometers, there were some artisans at that too, a very meager number. So there was some kind of market from that. Similarly, we wanted to infrastructure, there were no infrastructure, there were no sufficient light, there was no some kind of, even a minimum level of, a kind of their raw material resources. What exactly we did it here? We pointed out these are the most inputs which they require at a village level. So
So we basically came out with a, we call it basically repeating our experiences, MBST. So we call it market-based skill training and entrepreneurship development. What we basically mapped here, let's have who are those who are very keen to go for washing. Who are those who want to have, you know, stories for the raw material right at a village level, trust a village level. Who are those who can have a value addition tailoring products, all home furnishing and several kind of tailoring products right at a artisans level. Who are those who can have also a diverse profile of making craft, not only textiles, but even other one also now. Say for example, we have this, you know, the jute bag. Now it has come out with several ranges of jute-based crafts now. So they are making several kind of, you know, flower here, some kind of slogan here. Even several of the organizations are also buying directly from them. So the point I'm trying to say here, a cluster of product specific, the value specific skill training were given to them. And now it is basically created some kind of what we call it a common facility center. So there are n number of people who are already engaged on a regular basis for fasting. There are n number of artisans or skilled people who are already working in tailoring. There are n number of people who are having, you know, this craft work. There are n number of people who are making block printing now, which never used to happen here now. Now, while doing this, you know, now they have come out a center-based kind of enterprise. Because people used to basically migrate. But it so happened that they were definitely given the placement employment, but it was not on a permanent level. It was a more of a contractual level. This is what we went into the discussion with the owner of those companies, that how can we not have a social safety also, their stability in the employment. Ultimately, because they were paying hardly 600, 700, 800, sorry, 8,000. So ultimately, once we created this huge brigade of our common facility center, now they are having their own employment dimension in a very, very group enterprise. And now the people are buying all along, even from other states here now. So the point of, you know, concern I'm sharing with you, while creating a valuable livelihood chain, what we require, it is not only finance, it is not only infrastructure, it is not only, you know, the raw material and market. I would say here, ultimately, we as a social entrepreneur need to reach at a final point where we can create a sense of well-beingness of the community, the entire well-being.
I think I agree with you. So I think the point you're making is, it is a combination which is needed. That ecosystem to create is very expensive. So I think who finances that ecosystem is the question we have to answer. So that ecosystem you have done with various, where did that money come to finance that ecosystem? So oftentimes when you're looking at value chain, and most of it is, right, at the end of the day, whether you look at, you know, an artisan-based value system, which again has to go through technology. In my opinion, actually exports have come down, whether it's in leather or in textile, which is not a good sign. We can't be scared of market. We have to reach market, but that market will only come to us if we have specialization. For that specialization, where is that innovation, process innovation, technology innovation, who's going to fund all of this is the question that we have to answer. And of course, is our own aspirations, how do you create that? I firmly believe if people can make money, they will invest in it. If there's a way that they know, they will make money. And that money, just don't put it by color of money, which we at grade 4 decide is white collar job, is where our problems end up with, and the frustration that is there. I think I need to close. You tell me when you need to close. So he's the timekeeper, so I'm not. If I'm okay, you can take up this time.
I have two things I would like to ask and know your comments about that. First thing is, we're talking a lot about skill development, but again, upgrading of their skills. So for example, if we take in solar industry itself, so 10 years back, the industry is different when compared to today's skill. I mean, if there are people working from 10 years, there is a lot of change. But how are they going to adapt after certain period of time? That skill upgradation also is equally needed. So how do we address it eventually? Because are we going to go back to these people? And because they cannot come back to us, understand that, okay, there is some skill upgradation, I mean, there is new technology up here, so we would also learn this stuff. So someone from that background with 10 past fail or 12 past fail would continue doing the same thing because they'll be happy with whatever they have.
Okay, let me, I don't know the solar sector, so I will not comment on it. I think carpentry as a sector. Carpentry as a sector has seen tremendous change. You know, today it is completely power tool based carpentry, right? And a lot of carpentry has moved to manufacturing. It's not even remained as carpentry which you do where people go and do. So when we started LabourNet, I'm not even talking of a long period of time, right? 10 years back you had carpenters with power tools. Today carpentry is a manufacturing. It happens with CNC machines, it happens in manufacturing, it does not happen anymore with power tools. Including in apartment blocks where you actually fix windows and things like that, it's moved from wood to aluminium. So this is a value chain which required complete reskilling, right? Because that entire trade went completely gone. So I think these are places. One of the things that we had done with the with the carpenters who we had skilled and certified was move them to the nearest trade. And what would you think is the nearest trade? A carpenter using his skill set is not able to use that skill set because it's moved to manufacturing. Any thoughts? Sorry? Fabrication requires a different skill set because of the material which is there. No, strangely, it's in carpentry itself. Wood, identification of wood. You know, wood you have to have at various forms before it goes for manufacturing. So you have to actually move. And the good news with carpentry actually as a skill set is, it is not as dispersed. Even in the past, if you look at it, there are pockets of carpentry which happen. So again, going back, you know, if you find Vellore is a leather belt, Vellore is also a carpentry belt. People are coming from the same belt. Do you know where the number of carpentry manufacturing has come? Actually, it's in the Bangalore vicinity. Do you know why Pepperfry and other companies have set up their units are where? Jigni. Their units are in this locality. So I think we had to actually, you have to intervene out there into what is the nearest fit and move it there. And we haven't heard how many of us have heard that carpenters are no more useful? None of this conversation has come, right? It is so systematic that they got absorbed into value chains. And a lot of reskilling had to go in there because they stopped being traditional carpentry to becoming people who were actually looking at wood, A. Second was they moved into fitting. So if you look at all the, what is it called? Like you have the Russian decor and all this, right? So which you have the MDF wood. So you have, so here it is fitting which you need. Plumbers are better for fitters. Carpenters have actually moved out. So we have to keep looking at value chains to see what changes market will come. We cannot expect market not to come without changes. Today if we have to buy furniture, are we going to go to a carpenter and get it done or our house windows done? We're not. So that trade is not relevant. If that trade is not relevant, what is that relevance which you have to bring? And that's where I said, if you are able to show direction that a person can actually adapt, that entire community adapts. Many of them in the Vellore belt have actually gone into lock fixing. Lock fixing still requires tools. So you'll have to break it up into relevance and then do. Unfortunately, I'm not a person who knows solar, so I'm not commenting on that. But I'm just taking a similar problem where a complete, the entire industry went. So you had to reskill. Thank you so much for the opportunity.